Good morning to all of you. Today we are going to have a topic on Facebook Live, anger management. The most very important topic, especially when we were under lockdown, and you know we were locked inside our houses with all our people, our work and all that. Today we come up with anger management, and sir will take over now. I'll hand over it to him. I'll be back by 11:30. We'll have a chat at 11:30.
Very, very good morning. So Anish gave you a nice warm welcome. Let me take on from there. Can I start by telling you a small story? Yes. Once upon a time, long, long ago, you know, we used to keep on having wars. You know very well, you've studied history as a subject, and in history, they only taught wars only. We complain that, you know, children have so much of temper and anger, whereas the entire history session only talks about killing and conquering and anger, and this king did that and that king came and invaded this place and all that. So obviously children are going to be angry when they keep listening to all those, isn't it? Anyway, let me tell you about story about long, long back. You know, there was this two armies were confronting each other, and they were supposed to be going to war. The general of one of the armies said, so many soldiers on that side and so many soldiers on my side will get killed. So he called out to the leader of the opposite, to the enemy army, and he said, why don't you and I fight to death? We will fight, and whoever vanquishes the other, he becomes the leader of both the armies, and we don't have to have bloodshed. The other man agreed. Come on. They came. Both of them were very strong, very good soldiers. And they pulled out their swords and started fight, 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 fight. It went on for hours. Finally, it so happened that this general who had challenged, he managed to overpower the enemy. And that fellow fell down on the ground. His sword broke and was thrown away. Totally helpless, lying on the ground, badly injured, can't even get up. This man went to finish, because the condition was that you kill the other general and you take over the army, right? So he went with his sword about to chop off that fellow's neck. Then that man, in his frustration, lying down on the ground, he spit on this general. That's all he could do. He was so frustrated, so angry, and so helpless, that he spit on the face of this general as he came down. The moment he did that, this general who had won the war put his sword inside and stopped. People said, what happened? You have put him down, he is helpless, now you complete the thing and you become the leader of the enemy army. He said, no. This was done as a matter of honor, in order to defend my country against the enemy country. So if I was chopping off his neck, I was doing it for the sake of my country, in order for us to maintain our independence. But what happened? He spit on me, and that made me angry. It became a personal issue. Now, if I had cut off his neck, I would not have done it in defense of my country. I would have done it because I am angry with him. And that I do not want to do. How much of, you know, thinking and magnanimity it takes for a person to think that way. Perhaps that is why Aristotle, I think, said it, no, long back, that it's easy to be angry. But when to be angry, where to be angry, with whom to be angry, and how to be angry. That is not so easy, said the great philosopher Aristotle. So, let us accept that anger is an emotion, like any other emotion. You know that there are hundreds of emotions. We can be excited, we can be jealous, we can be curious, we can be fulfilled, we can be sad, we can be scared, we can be courageous. All these are emotions. Generally, behavioral scientists want to identify some of the very basic emotions. And many come out with different types of emotions. You remember in the ancient days, we used to have these people going around on Navratri, spreading the word of 9 different emotions through dance, through theater, to help people to understand. So they used to call those the basic 9 emotions. Western behavioral scientists have their own theories and explanations. But finally, it boils down to 4 core emotions, which I think almost all behavioral scientists agree on. Which are those 4? Happy, sad, scared, and angry. Happy, sad, scared, that is fear, and anger. So, if anger happens to be one of the 4 core emotions, obviously it is important. And despite the fact that some of us may try to bluff ourselves by saying, I am not an angry person, I don't get angry, you're fooling yourself. Everybody gets angry. Anger is a basic emotion like any other emotion, and that too it is a core emotion, one of the 4 basic emotions, from where a lot of other emotions arise. I'll tell you that in a minute. Now, if we understand this aspect, all we need to do is to acknowledge that anger is a basic emotion, which can come to me, which can come to any of my loved ones, my family, my colleagues in office, whatever. And the more I learn how to deal with anger, the better the life is going to be. In fact, let me tell you that out of all the emotions, including the 4 core emotions, I personally feel that the one that really requires most attention is anger. You know why? Because the destructive value of anger has steadily gone up. Anger can cause more damage than any other emotion. If I feel scared, it may put me off. I may lose doing something which, because I'm scared, I don't do it, and I'll get back again to it. If I'm happy, I'll be happy for some time, then again it will temper down. If I'm sad, slowly, slowly I'll learn how to cope with the sadness and I'll come back to it. During the period when I'm sad, I may not be doing much or I may not be reaching out, but it's okay, I can bounce back. But when it comes to anger, if anger is not managed, we can cause a lot of harm. Starting from anger against our basic people. Yes, Hema Malini, helpless situation does trigger anger. I'm going to talk about all the triggers of anger after a little while. Okay, so what happens is that if a person gets angry and has not learned how to manage his anger, he can cause a lot of damage. Today, for example, in a domestic situation, just now Anis was telling about how, in the lockdown situation, many of us are getting frustrated and we are taking out our anger on our family members and our loved ones. So the same way, starting from a simple thing like anger between family members, anger that we take out, unfortunately, on children because they are at the lowest end of the hierarchy. Anger against somebody in the office. I am a senior person, I have authority. So I use my colleagues, my juniors, as a means to vent out my anger, and I become extremely unpopular. Their motivation goes down. They don't feel like working with me. You know that it is almost been very universally accepted that people do not leave organizations, they leave bosses. Whether it is a small shop or a workshop, whether it's a giant MNC, whether it is a political party, anywhere, when people get so upset that they say, I don't want to continue to work with this person, the boss, the leader, and then they walk out. They would have fitted very well into the organization, into the work, they would have been happy with what returns or remuneration they are getting, but when they cannot get along with the boss, they say, enough is enough, I'm leaving this place and going. And if you psychoanalyze all the people who are leaving organizations, somewhere or the other, the anger factor comes into play, a factor. Anger plays a very important role. People who cannot manage. It could be the boss who is short-tempered and who keeps firing people and that's why they get upset. Or it could be the subordinate who has not learned how to manage his anger. So when he is being ill-treated by his boss, he doesn't know how to manage his anger. He does stupid things in that angry moment, and then things deteriorate to the extent where either he is thrown out or he has to leave by himself. So that is what I want to understand. From there, going up to nations and countries, there are countries who have nuclear power by which they can wipe out 1/3 of humanity if they unleash their entire nuclear power. If the person who has the control of those nuclear arms gets angry, loses control over his emotions and thereby loses control over his actions, he can wipe out 1/3 of humanity. That is the extent to which anger can play a very, very important role. And one very important thing, which I am sure you are aware of, let me just repeat it for whatever it's worth. Anger should not be suppressed. Anger should always be managed. Anger should not be controlled, suppressed, put down. That can have even worse effects later on. Anger has to be managed in the proper order. Just to give you an example, the gender divide, if you take. Men get angry, women get angry. Both of them equally get the basic emotion I'm talking about, anger, happens to men and women in equal proportions. It is a myth that men get more angry than women. You know why? Because of the way men express their emotion. When they feel some injustice has been done, when they feel upset over something, men have a tendency to bring it out in verbal and sometimes even in physical form. More and more men tend to raise their voice and shout, and in the worst case, like I said, raise their hand and hit somebody, be it a family member, be it a child, be it road rage in in the traffic, anywhere. So what I want you to understand is that men bring out their anger in very visual, very obvious, very expressive ways. What do women do? So many women, when they feel that injustice has been done, when they are very frustrated, they feel very upset about how they are being treated by someone or by circumstances, they break down and start crying. Now the basic emotion is the same. But women, or rather girls, have been tuned into crying out. Boys have been tuned into not crying, and when they cannot cry, they suppress the emotion and they bring it out in the form of shouting at somebody, hitting somebody, becoming bullies, and those type of behavior patterns where they say, see, boys are always like this, girls are like this. That is what I want you to keep in mind. Okay, let's start off with, in between I'll give you some quick exercises which you can do leisurely, but I want you to assess your own anger levels at every point. The first point of this is, if you feel that yes, I do need to do something about my anger, I think the first step should be to check out whether my anger levels have been there for a long time or whether they have significantly increased now. If you can't do it by yourself, you have to get feedback from somebody who is willing to be, you know, truthful to you. As Anna de Souza says, weak targets are the victims of anger. Yes, where does your anger lead to, and who are the victims? I'll come to that as I go along, step by step. First thing, as I said, is check out. If your anger has always been there, then at least it becomes easier for you to decide how to manage it, because I have this sense of injustice, I cannot tolerate this, I get very upset when that happens. At least you know that it has been there. But if you find that it has increased recently, your manifestation of the anger, you started raising your voice too much, you started hitting somebody, or you started becoming nasty to somebody, or you started walking out from places saying that I don't like this, I don't want to do that. If that has been happening, please check out your stress levels. It is not only because of the anger, it is because your stresses have gone up. And that can cause not just anger and temper outbursts, it can cause so many other equally important or more important issues. One of the most obvious ones is it raises up your blood pressure. Tomorrow you can be a victim of a stroke or a heart attack. You are laying the foundation for that if your anger levels are increasing recently. So you need to immediately move into the second level, that is, what are the sources of my anger? You'll be surprised how many of us do not clearly and properly identify the source. I'll give you a simple example. You go to a good restaurant, which is fairly expensive, and you order some dish. And the waiter very nicely, politely brings that dish, puts a plate over there, clears the thing, wipes it clean, and puts that dish and says, sir, please have. Yes, Shika, I agree that we need to identify our trigger words and body language of the person. I'm coming to that, in fact. Let us say that, you know, I start eating it and I realize that the taste is not good. It is too spicy, or it doesn't have salt, or whatever may be the cause, okay? What do I do? If I have not been able to be introspective and understand myself, I call the waiter and I raise my voice. Is this the type of food you have to give? It is so spicy, don't you know this? Now, what was the role of the waiter in increasing the spice or in decreasing the salt? Zero. He is as it is in the bottom of the hierarchy in the whole staff. He is handed over that dish by the chef and told, go and give it to table number 7. He has nothing else, no role to play. But we, you know, take out our anger on them. So somewhere along the line, I'm giving you a very oversimplistic example, but I want you to understand that people do not even understand and comprehend where is this source of anger coming from. Okay, now when I start shouting, why is it that for a simple thing like this, I'm losing my temper, making a show in front of the other customers who are sitting over there? Why could I not have told the waiter, please call the cook or the chef, I want to talk to him. He comes, I tell him, please taste this, isn't this too spicy? Perhaps he will say, yes sir, I'm very sorry, I will replace it. I'll send you a new dish. Finished. 5 minutes of inconvenience and it is over, no? But why is it that I did not? I knew that. I knew it was possible to get. I knew that in most likelihood that person will apologize and he will renew. But why is it that I didn't do it? Why is it that I started shouting? Because I carried the source of anger from other places to here, which is the question which Veenajit has asked. Is ignoring anger outbursts of people advisable? Not at all. This is what happened. I ignored the anger outburst of somebody, either because I love that person or because that person is in authority, or I felt the occasion is not right to retort over there. But I did not manage my anger. I did not rationalize it. And because I was feeling very upset and very restless, I decided to go to a good restaurant and have dinner. And unfortunately, at that time, I got that dish which has got less salt or more spice or whatever. And I was waiting to burst out at that. There was, in fact, a very interesting anecdote. There's a huge highway, you know, which has got a divider in between. Continuous traffic going up, and on the other side of the divider, continuous traffic coming down. One gentleman was going on the highway and he got a call because of which he had to take a U-turn and go back. He was called back. Now there was one place in that whole stretch of the highway where there was an opening where he could stop and take a U-turn and come. So he slowed down, went up to that opening and wanted to take a U-turn, but there was a continuous stream of traffic coming from the other side. And because it's a highway, people driving at mad speed, continuous. This man started flashing his lights. He started blowing his horn. Nobody is stopping. He's trying to wriggle, go 1 or 2 feet ahead. And somebody is putting his head out and saying, "Hey, don't do that. You'll cause an accident." And the fellow goes off. But nobody is stopping. After a long time, he sees one car coming. And that man puts his head out and sees. And puts his hand out to tell the people behind that I am slowing down, puts on the flasher and slows down and comes and stops so that this man gets an opportunity to take the U-turn. You know what this man did? He put his head out and said, "About time, you bloody blah, blah, blah. Last 20 minutes I've been waiting, nobody has stopped over here." And he took the U-turn and went away. He shouted at the one man out of the 100 people who actually obliged him. Believe me, this is what actually happens. Venkatesh has asked a very good question. What if you are the source of anger because someone dislikes you and keeps shouting at you and throwing anger tantrum? That's what I said. See, that person is angry with you, that person is upset with you, whatever may be, that person is an individual. But my emotions are in my control, or rather, they should be in my control. If I learn not to react, but to respond, that's it. Just because the other person is angry doesn't mean that I have to take that and I have to, you know, do the same thing which the other person is doing. In fact, to most of the parents, I guide them by simple ways that if you find that your child is getting a little too angry now and then, is having this temper outburst or seems to be irritable, just help the child by identifying the emotions. The moment he comes and either starts whining, "Nobody cares for me," or "I don't like that, that fellow, you know, this Suresh, I am going to see to it," or whatever he is doing, right? All you have to do is to say, "You seem to be very angry at Suresh. Right now, I think you are very irritated. I think you are feeling very frustrated because of certain actions of Suresh." Starting from there, please understand that the more you can identify and label emotions, the easier it becomes to handle it. And that is one of the reasons why I tell you that even when we talk about anger, you need to be aware that there are many, many cousins of anger, as I call them. See, I brought out this booklet called Anger Management. It is available in the office. You can tell Venu, he will give you either a soft copy or a hard copy. In fact, one of the things I put it right on the cover page is this very cute thing which says, anger is one letter short of danger. You add a D to the anger and what does anger become? It becomes danger. Anyway, the point here is that on page number 9 of this, I have given a little bit of a exercise. This is to identify the cousins of anger, as I told you. It could be that I am abusive, adamant, aggressive, betrayed, bitter, cruel. I can be hurt, I can be insecure, I can feel let down, I can be jealous, I can be possessive. All these are what go to create, a chain of anger. As Anna D'Souza said, chain of negativity increases because anger is reflected from one person to another. Forget about reflecting from the other person. I need to do something about myself. I think our prime focus should be on managing our own anger. Sometimes a lot of people ask me, how do I deal with that person? For example, Shobha says, whenever I'm uncomfortable with someone's behavior, I have so much of fear to tell that one. See, these are all issues which are important, which have to be dealt with. But those are issues of interpersonal relationships. They are not issues pertaining to anger. Today, my focus is primarily on how you can manage anger. There are so many ways. You see, people who come to us either for counseling or for, help out in their emotional issues, or those who even do our DCS program, they find a bit of a transformation. So today I thought, with all the lockdown and nobody is around, I have only Anis here with me. So I thought, while I take a quick tea break, let Anis share some experience with you, and then I'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Hello, back here. As promised, I told 11:30 I'll be back here. Just wanted to share a few things. As most of them know me, I'm here from more than 1.5 decade in Banjara here. Okay. So in this lockdown, we had an idea coming up saying we have not at all contacted our alumni, our students from last more than 10, 15 years. So we started calling all of them. All of a sudden, even we were not aware and the world came to a standstill. And so we started calling up all our students one by one and we were checking about their well-being. You won't believe, I was so happy that most of them, most 98% people, all of them remembered and they were so happy to receive a call. And moreover, I was very happy to see them that, yes, Anis, we remember you, we know, thanks for calling. And they were really, I really felt very happy. I felt like, yes, I've done a very good. Each day I used to be very happy talking to all of them. And then later I realized, yes, it was the right thing what I did when I joined DCS in 2013, completed in 14. It was a time when my children also are very small. So probably while they were growing up, the adolescent period comes in and so many things happen there. And that time I was really, this helped me out to handle them also there. And now when people talk to me, I feel so nice. I feel blessed that yes, at least in my life I've done this one very good thing wherein I can hear out people. And we are going, like This year also we have started our DCS, started in the sense the initial part of introspection, the self-introspection. The registrations have already started, they are still on, and we have still that early bird offer also. And you know, people who have already joined, they have their classes today, they have their practical session which is starting at 4 o'clock. So you know, that's what, as I mentioned earlier, a little while before also, that you know, the course had totally changed me, and that realization happened in this lockdown. When I started speaking to our own people, I really felt very proud that Banjara is such a huge family where we were very small, and each student is like a, you know, a concrete brick which is making us bigger and bigger and bigger and very strong. So anybody who is interested also, I'm very happy to invite, even you become a very concrete brick of Banjara Academy, and we'll be very happy here to welcome you. We are there open from Monday onwards, 9 to 5:30, full day, because we had restrictions and we were only open till 5 only for the last week. Before that we all were there at home working and talking to our students. So you all can walk into the office here, meet us. And apart from that, we do have students coming up for the aptitude test also. For students of 10th standard, 11th, 12th, when they are on the crossroads, they are not aware of what next they want to do, or they are confused. So these type of students also come. They have their counseling sessions. They do their aptitude test with the help of their report. They come and meet Purnima, our program's director, for the further counseling, and even Dr. Ali there, and they have their counseling sessions also. So we are full-fledged open from Monday onwards, and anybody who is interested for any counseling, we do have people walking in for personal counselings also. Earlier we had only for the telephonic counseling, but now people are coming here for the personal counseling as well. So you can call upon our phone numbers also, and I will just put it in our comment box here on the chat box, that you can contact our office numbers anytime between 9 to 5:30. Over to Ali sir now. Thank you.
Yes, I'm back. Okay, so as I told you, can you identify specifically what is happening to you? Am I more irritated? Am I feeling more frustrated? The more you can specifically identify which aspect of anger you are in, the way to deal with that is different. But definitely one very important thing to always keep in mind is respond, do not react. This is something which we perpetually have to keep in mind. Those who are impulsive, somebody says something and the person immediately responds, reacts. He says something, I want to say something even more nasty to that person. If I do that, then I have lost out on that. See, they say that the time period between the stimulus, the person who has hurt us, the person who has cheated us, or the person who has been nasty to us, from what he has said or done to the time when I have given him back my views on that, or my reaction, my response to that, that time is the most crucial time. And that is why we have this concept. People say that when you are very angry or very upset, count to 10. luckily me, it's a wonderful thing to control or manage your anger. Now, I don't say that literally somebody has been nasty to you or somebody said something horrible to you and you start saying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, no. It is symbolic that you, those 10 seconds will help you to respond much better. So you can just say, okay, 1 second, let me pull up a chair and sit down. Or let me have a glass of water. Or I'll just go to the washroom and come back in a minute. That is where that little time period helps you. If it is something much, much more deeper, somebody has hurt you very badly. I've had occasions where somebody comes to me and says, my boss has been so nasty, I'm going to go and throw the resignation on his face and walk out from that place. As a counselor, I do not solve people, I don't give advice, so I don't tell him, no, that is a bad thing to do, don't resign, I don't do that. All I do is to tell him, fine, I respect your wishes, you are an adult, you are a mature person. If things are so bad that you feel that I do not want to work with this boss and you want to resign, you have the right to do it. I have only one request. Don't do it today, do it tomorrow. Why, what's going to happen? Is it a Shubha Muhurtam tomorrow? No, nothing like that. Just hold on for a day. This is known as a concept of sleep over it. 24-hour cycle. You'll be amazed how much more rational, mature, and balanced response you have 24 hours later. Just give it that little time gap. It's extremely important. Vinita says, sometimes I feel we do carry some baggage, and as a result, if it is not clear, it comes out in an ugly way. I do understand that we need to let it go, but it's not that easy. Yes, Vinita, it's not that easy. If it was easy, nobody would have ever had anger issues or interpersonal issues, right? But we do need to. I've given the examples a few minutes back also, that we need to, you know, understand a situation, acknowledge it, that I am carrying this baggage because somebody was hurting me long back. And I need to resolve that because it is going to affect my relationship currently. Somebody does the smallest of thing and I get so angry that I start losing my temper about it. Anushka is asking, how delay with parents and elders angry at the home? Parents, elders, whoever it may be. If they are angry with you, do not react by becoming angry. They raise their voice and you raise your voice, nothing is going to come out of it, I can assure you. Neither party will feel contented. Neither party will feel that, yes, I got my way. It is what we refer to as a lose-lose relationship. Both lose in that argument. But if you delay, give some excuse. I told you, if nothing else, I just want to go to the washroom and come back. Nobody can force you, no, don't go talk to me. Or small things like that. And you see how you go and wash your face and come back and see how much you are in a much better position to see. Okay, Tina is asking, what if after 24 hours anger subsides and the person decides to resign to avoid toxic environment? We are just ensuring decision is not a response. It's not a reaction, in fact, you know, I'd like to specify that also, that it was not impulsive, it was not a reaction, it was a response. So I slept over it. See, 24 hours sleeping over it is symbolic. It could be that, okay, over this weekend, now that this weekend is coming, it's already Thursday or Friday, I will wait till Monday. Monday I'll go and submit my resignation. If necessary, Friday I'll even take leave so that I have a long weekend. Maybe I can put my thoughts in order. Maybe I'll do some meditation. Maybe I'll just chat up with some elders or some people. Maybe I'll just browse through what are the jobs available in case I resign. So many things can be done in that period of time. But it is an acknowledged fact that if you take time, rather than reacting, you would be responding. And the reason for that also that we are given is that anger has to be managed at three level: thought, speech, and action. First, control your thoughts. Get your thoughts under your control. then ensure that your speech is under your control, and finally going on to action under your control. Anuradha is asking, how do we help children to stop displacing their anger at parents? Yes, what happens in a family, be it a child to parent, parent to child, we look for the softest target. If there is a mother who is so loving, caring and obliging that the child goes out, gets angry or frustrated about something that happened outside, has not learned how to manage anger, and if mother just says a simple thing like, you know, put away your shoes, you have not kept your shoes on the rack, it's a trigger and the person takes it out. And you will notice that the person doesn't even say that I've come back tired, why are you telling me to, I'll put it later. Even that the mother can take it. But generally when a person has this frustration, the baggage as we were talking about, and he is dumping it on his mother, what he says is, all that time you're pointing out only my negative things. You don't see the good things that I do. Why are you behind me all the time, seeing where I kept my shoes, seeing this thing? You have nothing better to do. See how the conversation has gone into a totally irrelevant area just to take out my frustration, and knowing that my mother is such a soft person that she will not throw me out of the house or she will not beat me up. She's a very soft person, so I'm going to take advantage of that person. And that brings a very good question which Vibha is asking. How to deal with long accumulated baggage? Somewhere in the subconscious it is embedded. First thing is to pull it out from the subconscious to the conscious. That's what we do in counseling. We help a person to understand, yeah, I know when I was a child, you know, my father used to beat me up, but it's okay. I realized he was temperamentally like that. So now I don't want to hold it against him. I think, you know, I have gotten over. No, maybe you have not gotten over. Can we talk about it? When she starts talking about it, if you realize that one says, the way he used to, for smallest things he used to beat up, I'm so surprised the way he used to behave with me. When I was small, I can understand. Even when I became a teenager, you know, for small things he used to beat me up. I really don't understand what's happening. You can make out from that tone that the baggage has not been cleared. So now what do you do? Two steps. One is, understand your own emotions. Even now I'm angry with my father for what he did 10 years or 30 years back. Acknowledge it. The second is the empathy factor. Why did he do it? He was working very hard in a very ordinary position. He was denied promotions. He used to hate going to office. He used to come back from office very frustrated, and he used to take out his anger on his children. So the more I can do the empathy factor, I'm not saying by that you are going to excuse your father. No, you are only going to say that, okay, now I understand the reason for it. And you know how that helps. I was not the reason. Even though he was shouting at me or he was hitting me for my actions, actually he was taking out his frustration. No, the reverse, like Anuradha said, a child may take it out on the mother also. That he has some difficulties outside with some other person, but whenever a person sees a soft target, he takes it out. This is a very sad thing that happens very often in families, even in offices, for example. And boss starts shouting at the most timid employee, an employee who he knows is neither going to resign and go away, nor is he going to answer back. So he takes out his anger on that employee for the minutest things. As I said, today my focus is on dealing with your own anger. So if you find that you are doing something like that, you are shouting at your mother for no rhyme or reason, you are getting too impatient with your child, you seem to be raising your voice against some specific subordinates or team members, become aware. I go back to what I told you a few minutes back. Become aware of the sources of the anger. Take a simple thing like road rage. Left, right and center, if you go out on the streets of any big city, you will see people having what we call as road rage. this person is going on the proper lane, somebody else comes fast and cuts into this lane and tries to overtake him. Before you know it, this person has, you know, put down his glass and is shouting the most horrible obscenities to him. Is it that important? Did it really affect you? You got delayed by how long? 15 seconds. Does it really ask for this? Does he really think that that man has done such a big crime to stop the car, roll down the window, start shouting at the person? No, no. Then why did he do it? Because he already had pent up frustration. That's what Lilavati is saying. Strong, long standing stress comes out as anger. You have that stress, you have that frustration. I didn't get this promotion, or my spouse is not good to me, or whatever I am facing. And since it is not, you know, coming out in a proper manner, it comes out in this manner. How does a mother deal with it? Anuradha is asking. Individually, of course, any one of you has any issues, we'll sit and discuss, because there are a lot of, you know, specific factors which have to be taken into account. Age of the child, relationship, who are the other people in the family, so many other. But one or two very simple and general tips that I can straight away give you is assertiveness. You have to look the person in the eye. You have to have control over your emotions. You know, when a person shouts at you or is nasty at you, you know what he is looking for? He is waiting for you to lose your temper or shout at him. And the moment you do that, you have gone into his area. You have literally obliged him. Now he has reason to say, why did you shout at me? Why did you criticize me on that? Didn't you do this? So it becomes a ping pong battle. You throw the ball in my court, I throw the ball back in your court. But a far better way is, as I told you, first count 10. Okay, this, my own child or whoever it is, has said this which has made me very upset. I know that in the normal course I may have either shouted and got into argument, or I would have gone into my bedroom and cried my heart out saying that, see, my own so and so is doing this to me. I will not do that. I will take that time off. Then I will look at this person. I'll be aware of my body language. I should not be slouching or, you know, uneasy, or, and I should not be arrogant also. I will look at that person and say, huh, something I wanted to talk to you. Yeah, what is it? No, a little while back, you were saying this. Just describe whatever the person has said or commented. And I did not like it. It actually instigated me. I felt like raising my voice and telling you, I also have one or two, three things which I have, which I could have given it back to you. But I said, no, I love you. You are my own, whatever you are. So I don't want to do that. But at the same time, please understand, you can't take out your frustration on me. You can't keep raising your voice at me. You can't keep dictating things to me. You can't expect me to jump and respond when you ask for certain things. It's not going to happen. So you decide. If you want peace and calm, you make some reasonable demands. As far as possible, I'll try to oblige you. But if you become unpleasant, chances are that whatever I want to do also, I do will not want to do. Exactly as Nila says, no difference between you and the angry person if we also react. So how does it help? That's what I said. It becomes a ping pong battle. Okay. Navina wants to share something. I lost my temper on my 12-year-old child and slapped him. I know it's wrong and I realized it also. But later said sorry and said I shouldn't have slapped you and hugged him and made peace. But it is definitely better to manage in the first place. It's a journey of practice. Yes, it is, Navina, but it happens. We are human. We have our frustrations. We have our emotions. So you lost your temper on that person, be it your child, be it your spouse, be it your subordinate, whoever it may be. I want you to understand one very basic thing. When you apologize only for your action. That is, I hit you, or I said something nasty to you, or I shouted at you. But make it clear that I am not regretting the fact that I got angry with you because of your action. You know what triggered this thing? It was the fact that you told a lie to me. You said you have done your homework and you hid the book and you did not show me, and then I got a call from your teacher. Describe in detail whatever happened. And that made me so angry that I hit you, or I said this nasty thing to you. I still stand by the fact that what you have done is wrong and it deserved punishment. But the punishment that I gave you is wrong. I should not have hit you. I should not have screamed at you. Maybe I can take away some privileges. Maybe I can check before you go out to play whether you've done the homework or not. Maybe I can tell the teacher to send me by WhatsApp whatever is the homework so that I will be able to check on those things. These are the type of things. Yes, Smita has a very good point. Sometimes we get over it at that moment, but it stays subconsciously, and some other day we talk it out impulsively. You know what, Smita? You have not gotten over it. There's a basic difference between toleration and acceptance. Sometimes we think that we have accepted, but you know what we are doing? We are only tolerating. I'll never forget, many, many years back, there was an inter-religious meet. Very eminent and very knowledgeable people from different communities and faiths had come. And one by one they started talking about religious tolerance. Only if we have religious tolerance, we can live in harmony with all the other communities and people with different ideas and all. When my turn came, I went up and said, I'm extremely sorry to disagree, but I do not believe in religious tolerance. Can you imagine 200 very eminent people sitting over there? They got a shock. They said, what is this fellow, some terrorist or something? I kept quiet for 5 seconds to let that sentence sink in. I said, I believe in religious acceptance. You have to accept that the person with the different faith or different ideology has his own path. We are all travelers on a journey with the same destination at the end of the life. He is choosing a different path, a different vehicle, a different means of going. I am choosing a different one. I accept it. I don't tolerate it. If I only tolerate saying that this fellow is doing some stupid things, he is wrong, but I will tolerate, I am being magnanimous about it, that is when it comes out, what you said, no, that some other day, as Smita said, we just talk it out impulsively. Praveen says that when children do not wish to be given long explanations, if the child is not willing to listen, then you say, okay, then I'm straight away going to do this punishment. You're not getting TV or you're not getting pizza or this. Straight away, go ahead. Stop again and say, I'm still willing to give it to you if you listen. Just see the clock. I will take exactly 5 minutes, not more than that. If you're willing to listen to me for 5 minutes, then we can move forward in this. If the child is so impulsive and so short-tempered, no, I don't want to listen for even 5 seconds and box off, then the disciplining factor has to come in, some constructive punishment or whatever it is. Venkatesh says, in my experience, daily practice of simple breathing exercise, there is no doubt about it, Venkatesh, deep breathing, drinking a glass of water, closing your eyes in simple meditation, some mantra or whatever you personally believe in. Going out on the balcony and looking at the sky, the vast expanse of the sky. Each of these are 1 minute exercises, but they tremendously bring down your anger levels. The main thing to be kept in mind is, intellectually we know a lot of things. Whatever I'm telling you, there is nothing which you do not know. But do you put it into practice? Do we consciously make it part of our routine, part of our persona? That is where we fail. We say, I will do it, but right now I have this target, I have to finish this. Right now my child has got exams coming up and he is not sitting with that online classes and I am getting frustrated. First let me complete this. Right now my domestic help and maid servant is not there. I am so busy, I am looking after the whole household things, where is the time to think of all these things? There is always time to think of all these things. Yes, Parveen, even if you have tried it earlier, please try it again in a better way, more consciously and for a longer time, Parveen. That is very important. Behavioral scientists tell us that to, you know, get into the real mode of doing something, to make it part of your personality and your traits and habits, it takes a minimum of 3 weeks, they say. 21 days of continuous practice. If you do that, minimum, I'm saying, okay, sometimes it may take longer. Sometimes there may be a gap. For example, Sunita says, I don't shout but keep thinking about it. So you're tolerating. That's what I'm cautioning you against. Think about it, definitely, but think of a solution. Become more proactive. I have not shouted, good. I have not reacted. But I still need to respond, right? It's like what Anuradha said, that if my children, you know, keep on being nasty to me and I keep absorbing this, where do I land up? They think this is the right way. Mama is always going to be accepting whatever we can say, anything to her and get away with it. So they don't calm down. They don't say, oh, she's been so nice to us, she never shouts at us, so we should be nice. No, they think this is the way life is going to be. They grow up like that. They become adults. They become independent. They are doing so many other things. But with mother, they continue to behave in the same way. This is a word of caution to those of you who got, you know, smaller children, that we need to understand and accept that all these things have to be worked upon from the point of view of long range, particularly when we are talking, number one, about my own blood pressure, my own, you know, peace of mind and my own quality of life, and secondly, when we are talking about long-term relationships. I like this organization, I want to work here, but I've got this horrible team member or boss or subordinate or customer who's making life miserable for me. He's trying to make life miserable for you. He can succeed only if you allow him. Same thing with family members, closest of family members, be it your spouse, be it your parent, be it your child. You have to understand and work on the fact that it is in my control. I only have to practice. I am also human. I make mistakes. Like one of you said, I hit my child. Perfectly okay. Don't feel guilty. Don't wallow in regret. I've seen mothers who have hit their child and kept crying for the next 24 hours. And the child feels very happy. Ha! Mama is crying. Mama is saying sorry. So mama, I want a pizza and I want an iPhone and I want this and I want that. They play upon your guilt. So it's okay. As I said, you tell the child, I think hitting you or saying those bad words to you was not the correct way. So I apologize for that. I will try as far as possible next time to control myself so that I don't do all these things. Yet at the same time, what you have done will get punishment, maybe in a more constructive manner. Maybe the punishment will be that after dinner you have to come and wash the dishes along with the me, you have to help me in doing that instead of sitting and watching TV or movie. So those are the little ways by which we can work on the thing. As I said, it is not easy. Some of you said that, you know, we try this, it is not possible. Many of us tend to, sorry to say, give up a little easily. We are not consistent in that. And we use excuses. Now I am under stress. Now this lockdown is going on. Now I have this horrible boss. Now my child's exams are there. Now my cook is not coming, so I have to do the cooking. Whatever you may be doing, doesn't matter. The time to take up these important issues like anger management or any of these, the time is now. If you don't do that now, and if you allow it to fester, there can be a lot of long-term implications. One of the implications is that you keep isolating yourself from others. The relationship that could have been very strong, long-term and very warm, slowly starts developing cracks. And when you start having those type of issues, you go towards what I am going to be discussing next Saturday. We will inform you about a wonderful topic, which is the outcome of things like not being able to manage your emotions, or being impulsive, or having very strong views on certain things, and not being flexible, not adapting to change. What happens when you do that is what we will discuss, as they say in the TV serials, next Saturday at 11 o'clock. Thanks a lot. It's been a pleasure. Bye-bye.